critics and writers for and against prescriptive criticism. There have been times when people said that rules or laws are not at all important, and what matters is the expression of or personality of the author. And there have been times when these rules or laws, as we call it, have been glorified like anything. But criticism has always been this also, normative also, that it gives us norms of writing poetry. We shall go again to the slide and see how literary criticism is understood today, as it is shown on your slide. Today, the term literary criticism aims at the study of works of literature with emphasis on their evaluation. Evaluation, I think, sir, is important.
Evaluation is definitely important, because the very basic thing in criticism is to judge the value of a work of art.
Yes.
One can ask a question, what is he a judge of? If he is a judge, what is he a judge of? He is a judge of values. So evaluation is implicit in this word.
Yes.
And we value a work of art as a work of art.
Yes.
But valuing a work of art, actually, in valuing a work of art, actually, we distinguish it from non-literary kind of writing.
Yes.
Whereas when we try to evaluate a work of art, we try to find out the real value of it. We find out the merits and also demerits of a work of art. Whereas in valuing, mere valuing, we simply consider a minor work also to be a work of literature.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So this is the difference between valuing and evaluating.
Yeah. And just when you were saying that it's a matter of judgment and evaluation, we differentiate between good and bad. We differentiate between good work and a bad work, or a relatively lesser work. So this process of evaluating a work of art involves value judgment, and that involves that suggests that there are certain values, certain notion of good, of merit, that is universal, we may say. That is universal.
Yes.
Only then we can pass a judgment that certain work is good or certain work has certain demerits. So, just like as David Hume, we shall see later on also in this talk, suggested, that just as there is a universal idea of what is morally good moral about morality, we have a roughly universal idea. In the same way, the merit or goodness of a work of art, the excellence, literary merit of a work of art, about that also we have a kind of universal idea, that which is good for, say, a reader of English or a native person of England is good for a native person of India also. So what is great in England is great in India also.
Yeah.
Or what was great before four or 500 years before is great even today also. So there is an element of universality about this
of course
value system, we may say, that is involved in interpreting a work of art. As we shall now go to the slide again, the next slide is about judgment, the function of criticism. What is the function of criticism? And the first thing, as we talked about, was judgment. That, sir, in its strict sense, criticism means judgment. So, that is the first impression that one has of criticism, that it is a process of passing a judgment about a work of art. But as my senior friend Professor Patel rightly observed, that it is not just that. It is that, but it is not just that. It goes beyond that. And from passing a judgment, it goes into interpretation, and from interpretation, it goes on to evaluating a work of art. So it's a it's an activity which involves so many things, not merely passing of judgment, sir.
Yes, sir. The judgment is actually the primary function of criticism,
yes.
Literary criticism. But what the reader is interested in is the process through which this judgment is reached.
Yes.
And the process involves so many things.
Yes.
It first of all involves interpretation of that work. And this is the reason why people like to read works of criticism.
Yes.
Because without understanding the work, no judgment is possible.
Yes, yes.
So, in order to make the meaning clear, the what is implicit, in order to make what is implicit explicit,
yes.
He has to first of all interpret the work himself.
Yes.
Means the critic has to interpret the work himself, and then he can make it understandable to others.
Sir, shall we go to next slide?
Yes.
And it says the primary function of a literary critic is to arrive at and pronounce a meaningful judgment of value. Value, I think, is value of a work of art. That's what is understood here.
Yes, yes, yes. Whether it follows the aesthetic principles or not.
Yes.
This is the most important thing so far as the judgment of value is concerned.
Yes.
Because every artist has a specific desired effect in his mind, and he wants to produce the same effect amongst his readers.
Yeah.
When he tries to give vent or expression to his vision of life, he's as we know, a man gifted with a larger understanding of life.
Yes.
He has a deeper understanding of life. He is a man of extraordinary vision of life, and he wants to share this vision with his fellow human beings, that is his readers. So he expects the same sort of response from his readers, and the readers, if they fail to respond to his expression properly, they are not qualified readers.
Yes.
So every critic is supposed to be an ideal reader himself.
Yes.
He must be able to share the sensibility of the artist's heart.
Yes.
This is very important.
This is
very otherwise important. Mere principles may not be of much use to
yes,
him
yes.
in judging the value of a work of literature.
Yes, yes.
Okay.
So as we referred earlier also, Sarodai Bhavak, he has to be
yes,
a Sarodai
yes,
Bhavak
yes.
first of all.
Yes.
Then he can be a critic. And the work of a critic is to bridge the gap between the writer and the reader. The vision that the writer wants to convey, wants to express, has to be facilitated by critic, so that the reader is better able to understand, better able to grasp the vision that is communicated by the writer. So the duty of the critic, the job of the critic, is to bridge the gap between the writer and the reader. He comes somewhere between and facilitates this process of communication.
Yes, yes, yes. Walter Pater very beautifully says that criticism is an art of interpreting art.
Yes.
So this is what he wants to say.
That's what he said. By interpreting art, what Walter Pater suggested is this: by interpreting art, the critic makes the enjoyment of that art more enjoyable for the reader, or whoever is the bhavak, as we call it.
Yeah.
So he makes the enjoyment of literature better for the reader. That is the job of a critic and his responsibility. So all this leads us to certain things that we shall see in the later part of this talk, that what an ideal critic should be like. We shall see that later on, but first of all, let us see what is there in the next slide for you. That is evaluation. From judgment, we now come to evaluation. When a critic attempts to judge the value of a work of art or literature, he can be said to have evaluated the work. That is the process of evaluation. Judge the value of a work of art or literature, he can be said to have evaluated the work. And evaluative, judicial or normative, as we earlier also talked, that criticism could be evaluative, it could be judicial also, that is in the sense that it passes judgment about the merits and demerits of a particular work of art, and it could be normative, that it is, it prescribes certain principles and laws or rules, as we call it, for writing various kinds of literary works. So all these three, evaluative, normative and judicial, all these three functions are associated with criticism. And is, as it is in your slide, criticism, all these three kinds of criticism attempts to judge the merits of the literature in relation to a literary, social, moral or other value system. That's what
this is how, this is how they can decide the value of a work of art. There are so many norms or layers of norms.
Layers of norms.
Inbuilt in a work of literature, in a well-written work of literature, literary art, I would like to say. The critic, an ideal critic, has to take into consideration all these norms. He has, first of all, he has to feel the presence of these norms himself. If he fails to locate these norms observed, he can never be an ideal critic. Yes. So he has to understand or feel the presence of these norms.
Sir, literary, social, moral or other value system, indirectly we are now referring to what T.S. Eliot said, tradition, a system that is a part of a whole tradition, and a work of art is judged according to a particular tradition. Yeah. And by doing that, the critic places the work in a particular value system, that is tradition, whatever, it could be social, it could be moral, as you rightly suggested, or any other kind of value system. So these are the frameworks within which the critic has to evaluate a work of art. We shall go to next slide now and see T.G. Williams quote, sir.
T.G. Williams very beautifully says, the function of a literary critic is the evaluation of what has been written in terms of aesthetic principles appropriate to literature.
Yes.
So the word aesthetic here is very, very important.
Yes, yes.
I think aesthetic has to deal with the perception, what we feel beautiful as being beautiful in the whole world. So the sense of the beautiful is being appealed to. Yes. In works of literature also, aesthetic principles actually lead us in this direction.
Yes.
So actually all of the works of art are different forms of beauty.
Yeah. Very rightly.
Different forms of beauty, yes. Be it a painting, be it a piece of music,
yes,
or be it a poem.
Yeah.
All these are forms of beauty, and the artist is intent upon creating forms of beauty.
Yes.
Because his own vision is very, very beautiful. An ordinary man cannot have a glimpse of what he has in the form of his vision.
Yes.
So it is the duty of an ideal critic to work as an intermediary and make his vision clear.
Yes.
He is a man endowed with extraordinary vision of life and this world.
Yes.
The artist is a man endowed with an extraordinary vision of life and this world. And a critic is actually a literary critic, is a man endowed with a larger understanding of literature.
Yes.
So this is what comes to his help.
Yes.
And this is what enables him to speak on behalf of his friend, the artist.
The artist.
Sometimes he is in antipathy. Sorry, he has a lot of sympathy for his friend, the artist.
Yes.
There is no antipathy between these two entities.
Yes, yes, yes.
It is this sympathy for the artist's feeling or artist's heart that enables the critic to speak on his behalf. Sometimes he is so gifted or so understanding that he snatches away the pen from the artist's heart and suggests something new. So at that moment he is creative, highly creative.
Highly creative.
So actually, as Alexander Pope, a representative poet in the 18th century, puts it, both must alike from heaven derive their light.
Yes.
Both must alike from heaven derive their light. These born to judge as well as those to write.
Yeah. Both of them have to be equipped with that innate gift of gift that is creation and criticism of literature. Both the activities require that innate inborn capacity. And he rightly pointed out that a critic has criticism must be founded on a genuine sympathy for literature. But that does not exclude, that does not make him partial, I think. That's what
yes,
important
yes,
also.
Yes, yes,
yes. He may be sympathetic to literature. He may be sympathetic to the writer whose vision he is interpreting, whose vision he is clarifying before the reader. But that does not make him partial to the writer. He has to be impartial.
Yeah.
That is also.
After all, he has to evaluate works of art.
Works of art.
And in evaluation, finding out demerits also is involved, apart from finding out merits.
Yeah. So it's not just about praising a work of
praising,
art,
yeah.
It's about drawing our attention to the merits and demerits of a particular work of art. So sometimes T.S. Eliot also referred to this in many of his writings, that a critic is not supposed to be someone who goes on giving his opinion about a particular work of art. His duty in what Eliot suggested was to, the duty of a critic was to put the facts before the reader, and then it is up to reader to decide whether a work of art is has some merit or not. So this is a very, 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 very important difference that we have to keep in mind, that he must be sympathetic, at the same time he must never be partial. He has to be impartial and objective and stick to what the work says, what the work itself is. So that is very important for
surely,
us.
Surely. A critic can never afford to be indifferent to the importance of the disinterested endeavor, as Matthew Arnold said.